of the Congo and his hometown of Bukavu when he was 12 years old. He traveled through 7 African countries over 8 years, 10 years, until finally he was able to have a chance to relocate to the U.S. He met his wife in Iowa City, and now they've set up a home together in Boise. He received his U.S. citizenship in 2011. He is a dynamic speaker, an author, a poet, and an amazing ambassador for human rights and refugees. He really is an amazing person. He lives here again in Boise with his wife and 6 children. I learned tonight all of their names start with J. So good luck remembering those names. But and even more of his family have been able to exit out of the Congo and live in Canada. So he's able to see some of his family now, which is just unbelievable. And he tries to give back. One of the big things he did was he started an organization called Boise to Bukavu. So Bukavu being his hometown in the Congo. And he came to our office at Because International several months ago, and I was so excited to meet him and talk, and we wondered if we could connect some of our shoes to some of the kids in his hometown. And he painted just an unbelievable picture of the challenges that these amazing kids face and how something as small as a pair of shoes can help. And so tonight, your donations are gonna go to shoes for Fidel to take back with him to Bukavu. But I wanted him firsthand, I wanted him to tell you about these kids and what they face and why shoes are important.
Thank you. Thank you so much. First of all, I really thank you all for the hospitality you've shown people like me over the years coming to Idaho and, you know, in the United States. And I couldn't have asked for anything more than that. You know, like you said, in 2011, I became a citizen of the United States. And for the first time, I traveled a couple months ago, to the Congo, to Africa, Asia, and America. And I'm telling you, it is wonderful. there's nothing better. And, you know, I was treated really kind over there just because I had that passport. And when I came back, the best moment of my return, my whole trip, as I was flying back to the U.S., I got to the airport in Los Angeles. Everybody was passing by the customs, you know, they have the front face, they don't smile, they just... And as soon as I got there, they took my passport, looked at it, and looked at me and said, "Welcome home." The first time that I was accepted, that was beautiful. But anyway, talking about my, you know, a little bit of my, you know, my experiences with shoes and why I love what Kenton is doing, what you all are contributing to and helping him to do, is you know, growing up in the Congo, in Bukavu as a kid, we love playing soccer, and every time we go play soccer with a friend, I'll go back home with the, with wounded toes after, you know, clicking on a rock or something, and my toes and lights and everything, and my mom will take me in, you know, mend my wounds and take care of me and not angry at all, and you know, take a shower and sleep. But every time I went home with a torn shoe because I used it to play soccer, and I go home, I'll be punished for 2 days. So I'd rather play with that with barefooted and get hurt than use that one shoe that they bought for me, because maybe they'll have no money to buy me another one. That's how important shoes were. And the other experience is when I was a refugee in Zimbabwe, in the refugee camp, it was the same thing. We played soccer with barefooted and stuff. And one experience that I still remember, there were shoes, secondhand shoes that were brought to the refugee camp, soccer shoes, that were donated to us. And it was the best experience ever, because now our soccer team had cleats and could play with cleats in dirt. I could never forget that. But I went to Congo, back to Congo just last November, for the first time. To try to give back. And one thing I realize is most of the time we live our lives, when you live in an area, in an environment, and you think you know your community, you think you know your people, you think you know your country. But I realize that the reality is we don't know. We only know, and what I only knew about Congo before I went back with the intention to help was what was happening in my family and what was happening to my neighbors, and in maybe a little bit of what was happening in my neighborhood. But the reality and the deep down reality I did not know. Because nobody actually was open enough to tell me their stories and their real struggles, because there was nothing I could have done with it. So when I went there with intentions to help and to give back, I was able to see more than I knew about the Congo. So I landed in the city of Goma. My intention, I went there to help women in hospitals who were struggling with their babies and couldn't leave because they didn't have money. So they were locked in hospitals for months. I was just focused on that and maybe try to pay the medical bills and return. But when I arrived in Goma, I went to a small center where they showed me these kids who were coming down the mountains to have porridge, to drink porridge 3 times a week because they were malnourished and their parents didn't have enough money. So the center was feeding them 3 times a week so they wouldn't die from starvation. So I went to that center and met those kids and talked to the directors of that center, and they told me a lot about their challenges, and they showed me some of those kids. I helped them make the porridge and feed them. And then they took me on a journey to walk through the neighborhood to see their homes and where they live and their parents. And that's when I saw something that I'd never seen before. This is a few meters away from the governor's house, right in the city, not in the villages, not where you can get, it's like behind the airport, right in the middle of the city. But the city of Goma, this small city in my province, in 2002, it was hit by a volcano. So there is a volcano just a few meters right in the city, but we're told by the Belgians that that volcano will never erupt again. So the people got comfortable, they built all around the volcano. And we had this beautiful city by the lake next to the volcano. But in 2002, that volcano erupted. And there were cracks opening all over around the city, behind people's houses, and burning, everything was burned to ashes, and people ran to Rwanda as refugees. But after the volcano ended, people returned, but the houses were covered in lava, and people started rebuilding on top of lava. Those with money, they managed to rebuild, and everybody could just claim an area and say it was yours. But those who had no money, or who were affected by the wars, or single mothers whose husbands were killed by the wars during the war, they had no means and stuff. So they built a ghetto far away from the main, down from the city. And in those ghettos, there's no water, there's no electricity, and these ghettos are made of just of wood and boxes and some steel. And that's where these women live. Now, because of the volcano, there is a lot of lava rocks all over the neighborhood. And you have to walk through those lava rocks to get to the city. Now, when I went up there, I met with most of these kids, but then I found thousands of kids up there who did not make it to the center to drink porridge, and they were starving. And I started talking to them, and most of them, they told me one thing, that they did not go there because their sister, she's the one that walks their little ones. This is like a six-year-old telling me that she's the one that walks all the four-year-old and the two-year-old to the center to get porridge. But she couldn't make the 10-minute walk because she did not have shoes to walk through the rocks to get there. And that was the same story over and over. And I went, so thousands of these kids missed on a meal that's given only 3 times a week because they did not have shoes. So if all these kids had shoes, at least they'd have 3 times a meal, a week meal. Probably not enough, I know a lot of people, not enough to feed them, not enough to keep them alive for the week. But for them, that's essential and that's enough for now because they can't get anything more than that. And so I met this little girl, she was like 7 years old. Her mother was not there. I talked to her, very happy, very joyous. She shared stories with me, she introduced me to her little sisters, and then she walked me in her house. Her mother was not there, we sat there with a few other people. She started sharing stories and smiling and laughing and stuff. And this girl was actually starving. They show all her, big heads, ribs all sticking out and stuff. These kids were on the brink of death. And as I arrived there, the people at the center also shared photos of me of those who had died weeks before I arrived. Now, the only problem is that actually this is happening is because the organization around them, or the UN, the Save the Children, UNICEF and stuff, they do not help those people in the city. Once they land in the city, they drive their big trucks of goods and supplies to the villages to go and help the people down there. And they ignore those who are suffering in the city because they think that they should be able to find for themselves. But these are children with no parents, or with a single mother affected by the war and there are no employment in the Congo. So that's when I realized, so I had so many ideas on how I could maybe, living in the US now, I could find ways, opportunities, maybe to find a little solution for the problems, like clean water and don't this and that. But shoes seemed to be the most immediate needs to help them move from point A to point B to get some food at the center. And that's what I focused on. So when I came, I was trying to talk to people around the city. I met a friend who introduced me to Kenton, And I went to see Tintin, and the moment he showed me what he was working on,